Christoph Lameter on making kernel objects movable.
Thank you. So this is a pretty strange subject matter, right? Why would you want to make kernel objects movable? And I'm trying to tie that together. This goes back to the beginning of Linux, actually, and how we designed the memory subsystem is designed and how it's supposed to function and its problems today. And just about a couple of weeks ago, we hired a new guy in our company, and we have these large files that are 4 gigabytes. And he just tried to copy one of these files to the disk. Disk is extremely fast, about a gigabyte per second. So as he expected, in 4 seconds, it should be over. And after a minute or two, finally it ended. And then he tried to analyze it. Usually, in his prior employment, this was not a problem. Copying operations with small files worked just like that. And here, he could see that the disk was operating at maybe 5 to 10% of the speed. So he began to question what's going on. And so his colleagues that were there before said, OK, just do direct I.O. and everything is fine. And so, yes, you switch on, you open the file with direct I.O., you write it. Within 2 seconds, 3 to 4 seconds, the 4 gigabyte file is written to disk. So then that was dissatisfactory to the guy. He said, OK, you have this kernel developer here. I want an explanation. And how can this be? The operating system must be broken. There's a bug in the operating system. We need to have this fixed. And then I told him what is happening, actually. If you run to write a 4 gigabyte file to disk, the kernel cannot really give you a contiguous 4 gigabyte chunk. The kernel manages the memory in 4 kilobyte chunks. So if you do that, you now have 1 million data structures in the kernel that you need to manage in order to first store the data and then write it to disk. And so there's a lot of state changes going on these 1 million objects that you're constantly playing around with. There may be collisions and atomic updates and all sorts of things. So the OS is just occupied with itself without managing the large amounts of 4K chunks in order to get the data onto disk. And so I explained to him that this is due to the basic nature of how we have designed Linux. It can't be changed, so we use direct I.O. and he still expects the operating system to behave in a reasonable way, which means it should just copy the data in a correct way and in a fast way to disk. But that is not possible with the current way that our operating system works. And so I want to talk about how we could actually get there. And this has a lot to do with kind of finding a way to have contiguous memories. And to get contiguous memory, you need to be able to move objects. And that's why I think it's very important that we need kernel objects movable. And actually, a lot of stuff is already movable. So how did we get here? The Linux memory management is designed fundamentally with reclaim in mind. So the operating system will load 4K pages from disk continuously until the memory is full, and then get rid of the oldest unused pages, and then put new stuff in memory. And so it keeps on churning and churning with its 4 kilobyte pages. In an age where you just had maybe 16 megabytes of memory, this was not a big deal. You had a few thousand of these things. These days, when you have, let's say you have 4 terabytes of memory, you're looking at 1 billion 4 kilobyte pages that the operating system is now processing continuously and figuring out which one is the oldest and which is the right way, which they get new. And so this is an extreme overhead and it causes a lot of issues. And we have a lot of workarounds in order to deal with this situation. So, but let's say we constrict ourselves to a 4 kilobyte I/O size. At that point, we have no fragmentation. We can always get more 4 kilobyte stuff in and out. And so this doesn't cause us any loss of memory that we cannot longer use. But we can always replace 4 kilobyte chunks. So this is an ideal that we've been working on for decades and that we think is very important for our operating system. And so this has guided a lot of our decision-making process. But yeah, as long as we stay within the 4K framework, we have no fragmentation overhead, no internal and no external defragmentation. But then this idealized world is immediately scattered by the problem that we need smaller objects. And for that, we get slab allocators. slab allocators take these 4K basic chunks of pages and hack it into pieces and share all pieces of the page to the operating system where it needs smaller pieces of memory. These were the first causes for fragmentation. First of all, we had the Kelly and Ritchie allocator that Linus got from the early books in the 80s and 90s, and it was a very, very trivial implementation. We still have that allocator around as SOB in the kernel, and this thing basically manages a huge list of different sized objects and makes just the next thing that fits, it gives you. And so this is fragmenting memory rapidly. And after we got into issues with that back in the middle of the 90s, we saw that Solaris had a better approach, and someone from the Solaris team had published a paper on this. Bonswick was his name. And so some of the Linux guys got around and copied basically the ideas of that paper and implemented it in Linux. That became the slab allocator. That reduces fragmentation by organizing the different size allocations into categories of pages. So all allocations that go to a certain, have a certain type, let's say all dentries go into one slab page, all inodes go into another. If you do that, if one is freed, you can reuse it later for another dentry or for another inode. And so theoretically, that would reduce the issue of loss of memory to fragmentation. So that worked for a while, and with that we get into also, we have caches in order to optimize the behavior of these slabs, because the kernel is very much dependent on fast object acquisition and the allocation. And so especially the network stack was heavily dependent on that, and so slab was optimized with per-view caches and various optimizations to make that thing fast. And when I was hired by SGI to deal with NUMA issues in the Linux kernel, we started to replicating all these caches per NUMA node, and we had alien caches for remote freeing and stuff like that. So this came to be a huge set of caches, and a lot of memory started being caught in those caches. And that then brought about the slab approach, where we're trying to directly manage the pages and have the pages actually be cached instead of the objects in the pages. So we have a various history of allocators that deal with the issues of smaller stuff. But still, the slabs allocate the memory from the operating system in page size chunks. And when I take this page away from the page allocator, it's gone. It's used for the kernel, and it's dedicated only for the kernel objects. And so let's say somebody does a huge job and requires lots of inodes and dentries. Maybe you're just scanning through all the files on a file system. Then a huge amount of dentries and inodes are allocated, and after that, when you're done, you probably free all of them, right? They hang around, some of them usually, and you usually get a lot of pages where you have, let's say there would be 10 inodes or dentries that fit into a page. There may just be one left, right? Now you have a lot of these 4K pages where there's just one object that's holding onto the page, and now you have a lot of useless memory sitting around that you can't use, because you don't need dentries and inodes right now, but since there's only one object in this page and the page is dedicated to this type of object, you got to keep this stuff around. And that is one of the first things that we noticed, where we waste a lot of memory and where we can't reclaim the stuff, because we would have to move the object. What we really wish we would do now is we would go through all the pages that only have one object in them and put them all together in one page and get rid of the other 9 pages. But we can't do that because we cannot move memory. Then, on the other side, we also have the need for larger objects. The 4K size is tiny if I want to do my 4 gigabyte of data transfer. This 1 million 4K blocks have to be managed, and that's to write a file. And that really can't be fast. How can you ever cache even the in the tribute caches the data for 1 million pages? So this is a fundamental basic issue for the kernel. We must be able to do I/O or handle memory in larger blocks of contiguous data. If we do this in these 4K chunks like we do today, then also the devices must support that. Most of the devices that support Linux these days have support for huge scatter gather lists. You can tell them, here, I have these blocks of 200 or maybe 1,000 4K pages, and these are the addresses where they all are. And so the devices are optimized then to walk through this list and pick up all the pieces that are all everywhere over memory and try to optimize that and write it in a fast way to memory. This complicates the design of the hardware and causes inefficiencies at that level, because usually the scatter gather lists are limited, and we've often had cases where we could not reach the I/O of the device because we ran out of scatter gather lists, or because the way that we had to process the data from various chunks of memory, it was difficult because the memory was not linear. And memory is organized so that linear access would be fastest. So this also limits your performance. Then if you have all these 4 kilobyte pages around and they are discontinuous, then you have TLB coverage issues. So you have to do the translation from the virtual address to the physical address. For each of those, you need to have one TLB entry. If you have a contiguous memory for one object, then you only the processor usually can prefetch the next entry and can avoid the latency. If you go randomized, like we do today, with the scatter gather lists, then you have a lot of performance loss because you have TLB misses and you have to refetch stuff. If you have these scatter gather lists, you have a huge list of pointers that you have to traverse, and this is very bad for our contemporary memory subsystems. You want locality. The pointer lists, the massive pointer lists, are just contrary to what good performance would require on that level. These are all issues that arise as time progresses. Because now what we have is the file sizes are increasing, the I/O performance is also increasing rapidly, but the page size stays the same. So we have more and more the need to manage larger and larger sizes of these lists of 4K objects in order to do I/O, in order to manage memory. This results in a massive amount of overhead in the kernel, and this overhead is going to increase every year and and at some point we need to face this issue and do something about this. And there are also other devices that that actually require large contiguous memory, like some NICs of much faster graphics requires large frame buffers. Embedded devices on Android also have actually no special allocator called the continuous memory allocator, which is dedicated to contiguous memory because the main allocator doesn't provide that. And that has also its issues because it's not properly integrated into the kernel. Some subsystems actually work faster when large sizes are available. The slab allocator that I helped create can detect, okay, the OS has larger contiguous memory available. If so, it takes advantage of it and it reduces its management overhead. So if I can get a 16 kilobyte frame, that can stuff more objects in there and I don't need to manage the pointers for 4 kilobyte pages instead, right? So this increases the performance. When the memory becomes fragmented and the kernel can no longer provide these contiguous memory segments, the allocator falls back and then does a less efficient operation and manages these 4K objects again. But then system performance sucks. So as far as I can tell, there's no way around the fragmentation problem. I've talked about this actually for the last 10 years, and I've been told repeatedly that this is not a problem. We can work around these things, and I think at some point now, this year or next year, we are at the end where everybody sees that this can no longer continue. memory gets garbled, there are gaps that are wasted and not fit for further allocation, right? So it can't be continuing like this. Then we have various remedial techniques that we have used in the kernel. We have fragmentation avoidance that we have put into the slab allocators. I'm doing special measures in my allocators to avoid creating these gaps. Let's say we know on another NUMA node, we have a block that has only one object, and we now want to get more memory. We can put that into the other NUMA node in order to fill up the sacrificing now memory locality for fragmentation and things like that. So that's possible. The page allocator is optimized that on boot up, it gives you a contiguous list of pages. Right, so you get the pointers, but they're always on the next page. And the I/O subsystem can figure out, oh, this is happening. And I can condense those and basically give the I/O subsystem, at least for at this point of operations, a start and a long size to write to disks. So at least when the system boots, you can enjoy full performance. After you run for a couple of days, everything goes down the hill, and we're back with the 4 kilobyte pages, and maybe the controller fails because it cannot handle the scatter gather lists. But at least for the initial performance measurements after you boot the system, you are good. Yeah, right, exactly. That's when you run the benchmarks and when you prove to your customer this works at full speed. The page reclaim logic also contains various techniques and that come and go also about trying to find ways to get these issues addressed. Then another solution is to allocate huge pages. We can actually manage 2 meg pages or 1 gigabyte pages in the kernel. The problem is these have to be statically allocated on boot up or dynamically generated while the system is running for the huge pages. That only works if memory is not fragmented or if you can still run through some defragmentation. So typically, if you want to be sure you can have these large contiguous segments, you will, on boot up, specify parameters and ensure that you get your number of pages for your application. And then the application will do special calls to reserve these pages for itself and then do things with it. This is a pretty intense approach, a manual, but it works and it's widely used and it gets more and more widely used these days. And I had to tell my guy, and I said, OK, I can do it with full speed. I told him, yeah, OK, if you now use a huge page for it as well, you can reduce the overhead even more and go faster. And then he had to learn how to do this because he came from an enterprise class environment and had never dealt with these issues. And so this was part of the training cycle of coming into our company. How do you deal with all these special measures to get full performance out of the system? So some device drivers do pre-allocation of memory on boot up so they can avoid dealing with fragmentation later. So, but this means that the memory for the device driver is gone for good. Even if the device is not being used, the device still has this huge buffer allocated on boot up and in case it's being used. This is not a really sustainable approach and it's not dynamic as it should be. And we have also page-based defragmentation. One of the things that I was able to make movable is the user space pages to page migration. This is a side effect actually of stuff that SGI wanted when I worked for them. They wanted to optimize an application to run on a special NUMA node. So you need to be able to, when the process ran, to figure out is memory on a different NUMA node and then move the page from another NUMA node physically to a node that's closer. And this means that the physical location from a page can be moved, but the virtual location stays the same. If you can do that, then you can do also a defragmentation pass. And that was implemented later, and that allows you, at least to some extent, to do defragmentation and reconstruct large contiguous segments of memory for the user space pages. Yeah. So if you want to do defragmentation, you must be able to rearrange the objects in memory in such a way that large contiguous sections become available. That's possible with the page migration. But we just talked about slab allocators that manage all the small objects. They do not support that. And so when you have a large section of dentries and inodes, then you have a lot of memory pinned all over the place, and you shot holes in memory that you can no longer reclaim from, but you can no longer defragment, and that limits your large contiguous allocations. So the rearrangements, you want to move objects, is there in the way of creating contiguous memory? And for inodes and dentries, that is a key thing that has to be done. So this is the existing defragmentation logic. It's based on page migration. So the pages are moved on a optimistic approach. So the kernel tries to move the page, and it tries to find out, can I see all the users that use the page right now? If it can track that down and can isolate all the users of the page, then it will move the page. If it cannot do that, it will just give up. So this is just an approach where you attempt it, and there's no guarantee that this will happen. And this works for NUMA because it's just an optimization. For defrag, you actually want a deterministic guarantee that you actually can move the page. So there are still some issues there. And the problem, again, is that the kernel pages that contain the kernel objects are not migratable at all, and are mixed freely with the user space pages. So we have, as a result of that, we have some existing APIs to move objects. We have system calls to move user space pages. There's actually a move pages system call in the OS, where you can tell the OS, okay, for this process, I want you to move the following pages to this NUMA node. In the kernel itself, the address space operations have a callback. You can say, okay, this part of the address space now can be moved in a certain way. So there is stuff already there. The problem is inode entries don't have anything like that. And I had an approach back there in 2007 that I had a patch set that was never accepted where I would implement that on the base of the slab allocators with callbacks. So this is certainly one approach. So the challenges in making the kernel objects movable are the following. So we may have arbitrary references to any object. It's difficult to track these references down, particularly only if you have a ref count. If you have a user space page, you can figure out which processes map this page, which devices use this page, and you can track down all the references. You would have to do something similar for the kernel objects. There may be complex allocation freeing techniques in use. Many of these kernel objects are very performance critical, and therefore they are very enhanced and complex allocation systems and freeing systems in use with RCU and stuff like that. This is pretty complex. This seems like a very daunting task, but, and people have told me this is impossible. But in 2003, people taught me that page migration was impossible. Nobody believed that this was possible. And we had a project going on for 3 years with Hitachi and various Japanese vendors on SGI, where nothing went into the kernel because people just didn't believe that this was possible. So we can basically adopt the same things that we did from page migration. What we did in page migration is we did an optimistic attempt to track down all the references. Do not migrate if you cannot account for everything, otherwise you migrate the object. You need to have callbacks for the slabs in the same way that address space operations work these days for user space pages. So when somebody creates a slab cache or a class of objects in the kernel, that subsystem has to provide a function that will track down all the references to the page and remove the references and then bring the object into a state where it can be moved and then reestablish the references. That means additional work, but this would allow that to happen. And that was the approach that was used by my implementation in 2007. The other thing is we could make it more generalized. We can have garbage collection in the kernel. If we can mark all pointers in a special way, then we can provide a generic way to recover memory and to move pointers. We could do a scan of all memory like Java does. And we have the problem with garbage collection times, but we already have a reclaim which takes an indeterministic amount of time, so maybe that will be acceptable. But then this also is a significant intrusion in terms of the kernel techniques that we are using elsewhere. We could do this step by step. Because people didn't believe that page migration was possible in 2004, what I did is I said, okay, we know that we can push a page onto a swap, and we can swap it back in. When we do this, the page will show up in a different location. So this is a swap. This is a page migration attempt, but it's very slow, but it's working. So in the first step of page migration, I implemented this, and this was acceptable and reviewable by the kernel developers and by the MM specialists. Because the swap code and the page encode is an established path that everybody knows. And so after that was working and accepted and stable, I connected the push out and the push in phase and made a direct copy possible. And with that, you then had an ability to move pages from one place to the other. And it was then accepted that this is possible. And at that point, you can then optimize the path. And at that point, it became a separate subsystem. And at that point, it became page migration, which was isolated from the page in, page out system where it first started. And I think something similar can be happening here with the inodes and indentries. Because inodes and indentries can also exist on the metadata of the disk. So if we could push the INET identities onto the disk and then have them come back in another location, that would alleviate the fragmentation. And once we have that working, we can then work on ways maybe to copy the objects back and forth directly in memory. So we could do a soft approach and go to that, the same direction that we've done before with the page migration. And ultimately, you want to just move the pointers directly without going through all the gyrations there. But yeah, it's been a long future. OK, that is what I have to say. And
hello, Christoph.
Hey, Matthew.
It's lovely to see you again.
Yeah, good to discuss this stuff again.
So I don't think the step-by-step method is the right approach to take for this.
Okay.
I would like to see us go in the direction of having a callback from the slab allocator to the subsystem that says, please move this object.
So you agree with making the objects movable?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, great, yes, hallelujah.
Okay. Set up your machine so that it has zones areas of memory right. which are tagged as movable, and only bits of the kernel that say I can move my objects are allowed to allocate from that part of memory. So the advantage to the kernel developer of saying GFP movable is that they get to allocate from a much larger pool, so their allocations are much less likely to fail. The disadvantage is that they have to be able to move their object. So if slab honors GFP movable, and it might or might not pass that through to the page allocator right now, but that's a simple measure for me to fix. We could have, and I'm thinking particularly about the radix tree here, just because I've been working on it most recently, I know that code best. It uses a slab, and if you give me a callback, I can move any single radix tree.
Node. Okay.
Good, so yeah. I can definitely do this defragmentation. Mm-hmm. I'm totally willing to work with you on this. Mm-hmm. I don't know about inodes and dentries. I think inodes and dentries are the ones to focus on. I think those are our most important things to defragment.
Yeah, that's most important to the one behind you.
I think one of the things you've got to look at here is how inodes and dentries are actually used and freed. The algorithms that walk them and so we might have actually freed the object, but it's not yet freed because we haven't gone through a RCU grace period. So basically, one of the things we've got to consider there is all the algorithms that are walking these structures, you are going to need to factor in RCU grace periods and synchronization periods to enable this sort of movement to work. When you consider the complexity of the dentry cache and the dentry cache path walking and so on, I think there's maybe one or two people that are capable of determining whether that will actually be able to work and be possible. Alvero is probably the only person that could tell you that off the top of his head, but he's not here. And Willy wants the microphone back.
Well, The approach that I tried in 2007, I failed because I couldn't do the file system level stuff. I was just not clear on exactly how that worked, and it was not acceptable to the guys at the file system layer. I think the approach at the higher level in the slab is fine, and I made sure that all the guarantees are there, so we could revive that stuff.
So I just want to agree and amplify with what Dave was saying, which is that, yes, a lot of this stuff is RCU-based, and you do need to say, but I don't think the slab needs to take it into account. I think the subsystem needs to take that into account. In the radix tree case, I'm fairly sure every other case, I can tell you that an object has already been placed on the RCU list. I don't want to tell you that. I can tell. And so if you call me and say, hey, please move this, I can look at the node. I can say, oh, that's already been freed. I just need to wait, and I can call synchronize RCU before I return to you.
The slab allocator knows that the object is free.
As long as that callback's allowed to block,
yes,
we're good.
This is all already. if you create a cache with RCU objects, you need to flag that when you create the cache. My slab cache knows about what's going on with RCU and it tracks all activities. So this is not a problem.
What happens to those pointers while migration? You know, suppose I'm in use inode entries, not the one that is freed and waiting for the grace period to finish.
Mm-hmm.
In use inode entries, if I want to move those objects, what will happen for the kernel address, which is like, you know, you convert them to migration PTEs, or what will happen?
The slab stuff only deals with the freeing operation. So if you do an RCU free, then the slab knows about this. But what you do also with the RCU is another issue. If you RCU free an object, then you cannot migrate it anymore because it's going to be gone anyways. Why would you do this?
No. What I was talking about is while freeing, I understand. Like the objects which are in the RCU grace period to be freed, we can actually reclaim them.
Why would we move it?
No, to reclaim them faster before the grace period is finished, right? We are not waiting for the grace period to be finished, like the scheduler event to happen on all the CPUs.
Well, we need to wait for the grace period to finish because there may be accesses to the object. That's why the grace period is there.
No, to get the page freed so that we can do allocations, larger allocations.
Mm-hmm.
What I was primarily asking for is what happens to those kernel objects which are getting accessed? What will happen to the PTE entries for them? Like, you know, how will you dereferent them? How will you, like for user space right now, we tell that, you know, you have to wait for this access because this address is under migration.
Mm-hmm.
What happens for kernel objects? The kernel will wait for the object migration to finish?
The kernel will do a callback and wait then for the subsystem to give it a clear that the object is ready to be moved. And the kernel subsystem has to clarify that the object is in a state that it can be moved. So it's up to you to write the proper callback to do that.
Just to finish that off, with all of these lockless algorithms, there is no way to know that there's no access going on to the object.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, I mean, how do you wait for something when you are doing concurrent lookups that are lockless?
Well, this is an issue of the subsystem, right? The subsystem needs to make sure
that the object is not being
accessed.
That's my point.
Yes.
This is the complexity with the dendry cache.
Yeah.
Getting that sort of thing to work is, I mean, I'm sure there is some way of doing it, but I'm not sure there's many people that are going to be capable of actually doing it and being able to say this will work.
Right, yes. And that's
they're not here in this room, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a kernel programmer,
right.
So I don't know whether this is a an easily answered question, but it kind of sprung out of what you were saying about pages.
Mm-hmm.
And knowing that if you could swap a page onto the swap and swap it out, then you could move it. Aren't inodes and de-entries fundamentally objects that are on the disk?
Right.
And could you not then just invalidate them and say, okay, next time I fetch them, I'm going to fetch them into a more convenient area?
Yeah, exactly. That's my basic idea. That was also the idea of the 2007 patch set.
Yeah. So the problem is that de-entry might be pinned right now. We might have something. We might have another process in the middle of reading something out of that de-entry. So we can't just get rid of it. We've got to wait for that other process to no longer CPU to no longer be accessing, no longer have a pointer to it. And that's why the RCU point that Dave was making is so important, because we have the ability to know when nobody is looking at that any longer.
Anybody else? Okay.
We'll just leave the microphone down here. Just another question. swap out, swap in, and so on. The biggest issue with inodes, we can't just swap them out because of the fact that in file systems, a dirty inode is likely to be journaled. And if it's dirty in the journal, it's going to be pinned in memory and so it can't be moved.
Yeah.
The other thing is that the dentry pins the inode as well. So there's no point trying to free up inodes while they have a reference count.
Right. The same thing with page mark. If the page is dirty, you need to first spread it out before you can move it.
Yeah.
So similar situation.
Yeah, so I mean, basically, there's a, with the slab objects, it's not just, oh, we just look at these objects. I think you know this, that there's an actual hierarchy essentially reclaim order that we have to go through to sort that out. And even when we get to an inode that we say, oh, it's unused, it's on the LIU so we can reclaim it, the file system then might look at it and say, no, I've got to do a heap of work on that before it can be reclaimed.
Yeah.
And for example, some file systems dirty the inode in the reclaim path. And so they do IO and do transactions and so on in trying to reclaim an inode. So it's not as straightforward as the page migration case where you've got a clean page and it can just be copied to somewhere else. You might have a clean inode and you think, okay, I can just trash that, and all of a sudden you've generated another megabyte of memory pressure to do whatever the file system needed to do to clean that up. So there's going to be a lot of constraints on what we can do here. And I think it may be best to try to get one subsystem to do this cleanly, whether it be radix nodes.
It's that simple, let's just do that.
Yeah. There are other slab caches that are purely in memory that may be good targets to try as well, but I think the dentry cache and the inode caches are sufficiently complex and have sufficient dependencies that trying to address them first is going to be very difficult.
Okay.
I think it's best to try with something that is purely in memory and has no write back or clean dirty type situations to deal with. Just page invalidation and you can frame up.
I agree. Let's just use me as the guinea pig, and I'll be quite happy to try this out and see whether it works. I think you're maybe taking the wrong impression from Christoph's suggestion, which was that we only do we drop the inode. I think we remove the inode and then it can stay clean.
Dropping it and then moving it, it's potentially difficult because sometimes the file system underneath the VFS has references itself.
We are running, starting to run behind schedule now, so I think I might bring that to a close. We let that run over a little bit just because we did start a bit late. So yes, please feel free to continue discussions after over afternoon tea. Okay. Thank you to Christoph.